You're an agribusiness executive navigating an increasingly competitive market while trying to grow your company. Mergers and acquisitions are pitched as an accelerant to growth, but many M&A deals destroy more value than they create. Welcome to the Pacesetter Pod, where we explore and reveal the perspectives, insights, and approaches for successful mergers and acquisitions. Here's your host, the Integration Pacesetter, Joe Mosier.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Pacesetter Pod. I am your host, Joe Mosier. This show is dedicated to providing you, the men and women, the leaders of the food and agribusiness space, with an edge in achieving the growth of your business through better strategy execution and winning strategies for M&A integration. I appreciate you joining us today. It should come as no surprise to any of us how important communications are to success. Every single employee engagement report that I've ever read has always had communication at or near the top. And the same goes if you look at feedback received on strategy implementation writ large, large-scale change initiatives, major capital investments or R&D projects, companies going through rapid expansion, and similarly or conversely, companies that are going through cost-cutting or layoffs. Communication is paramount. It's one of the main pain points. And M&A, frankly, is no different. Now go out and pick up any book on mergers and acquisitions and or M&A integration, and all the literature is going to highlight this. They're going to highlight that it's strategically important to have effective communication plans in place in order to get to deal success. And so whether that is communications to the company being acquired, to employees on both sides of the trade that are worried about their positions and their employment, could be to customers, suppliers, the community, general stakeholders, people want to know what is happening. And communication is the way that they expect to receive that awareness and that knowledge and that information. For example, people want to know what IT systems are going to prevail. They want to know what the org structure is going to be. They may ask what the go-to-market strategy is going to look like. They want to know how many plants are going to be operated. What changes can they expect to compensation and benefits, et cetera. And this is just scratching the surface. And so as a practitioner, this is where we commonly jump to all the different tools that are available and useful in managing communications. Things like stakeholder analysis, where you plot out the affected parties, where they're at, what the impact is, what the likely reaction is, and what you want to do to get them where they need to be. We have communication plan templates. We have a variety of communication mediums, whether it's intranet, message boards, Slack, emails, town halls, department meetings, short videos from leaders, et cetera, variety of different mediums. We talk about communication frequency. We talk about putting together the talking points and maybe the frequently asked question documents or FAQs. And then, of course, we always give a lot of airtime to the importance of feedback loops. So not just communicating out, but then having methods in place to hear back from those different stakeholder groups. And yet with all of this awareness of the need for communications and all the literature and the best practices that are available to help us do it, we all still underperform at communications. And maybe it's because it's not about having a better template, or maybe it's not about having the most comprehensive stakeholder analysis, or maybe it's not about increasing the frequency of all your communication touch points, how often you send the updates via email, how often you meet with people, the frequency of your town halls, et cetera. Going from a quarter to monthly may not move the needle. Maybe this is about not trying to avoid or minimize the disruption that people are feeling, and just accepting that there are unavoidable impacts as a result of large-scale change, particularly in M&A integration. But just because this disruption and these impacts are not avoidable doesn't mean we're helpless. An unavoidable impact still needs to be acknowledged and addressed. And so today I want to share three insights to really help understand what makes for an effective communication strategy. And this is not going to take the place of a stakeholder analysis. It does not stand in for communication plans, and it doesn't replace all the other work that you need to be doing to distribute the important information and to have those feedback loops. But this will put you and me and your leadership team members in the seat of the disrupted, in the seat of the person who finds themselves suddenly neck deep in the change that they had no part in. It's the change that you introduced by performing a merger and acquisition. And to learn these three lessons, we really don't need to look any further than what happens when passengers, the airlines, and a major winter storm system all cross paths. And in this story, they all cross paths in the upper Midwest one Friday evening in early March. So I was attending a client board meeting and an all-employee, all-hands meeting near the end of an integration effort. So I'm sitting there on Friday afternoon on site. It's about an hour and a half drive back to the airport. And post-COVID, there's just not that many flights into the small regional airport that I fly in and out of. And so I already had my plans booked to fly out on Saturday morning and be home before lunchtime to relieve my wife of kid duty and take over for the balance of the day. So again, visiting a small location in the upper Midwest where the client is based, and then living myself in a rural agricultural community in Northwest Michigan means that you don't fly direct. And when you don't fly direct, that puts all kinds of pinch points into your travel. Now, that Friday afternoon, there were clear skies at my point of departure, and they were even clearer at my point of arrival. But my connection, the airport that I was flying through, was getting completely snowed under. And after several hours of a very intense, very heavy snowfall, airline operations just came to a grinding halt. So this is one of their major hubs. And it was the only hub that flies directly into the airport that I originate from and I'm trying to return to. So when I should have been home by 11 a.m. Saturday, now I'm looking down the barrel of I might be lucky to get home by early Monday morning. So here I am. I'm a happy and loyal customer of this airline. I'm going about my business, trying to get home. And then just with a snap of a finger, I am suddenly helpless. I'm a little bit agitated and I'm definitely being held captive now, whether I want to admit it. I'm being held captive to the strengths and the shortfalls of the airline's processes to sort all of this out. And so I admit, as we go into this episode, this is an imperfect metaphor. The airline didn't make an explicit decision to conjure up a blizzard and all the winter weather that stranded passengers. So that blizzard is not the same as an M&A deal. But how the airlines handle stranded passengers tells us a lot about how we can help employees, how we can help customers, suppliers, and others that suddenly find themselves surrounded on all sides by either 3 feet of snow or by an M&A integration. So the first point that I want to highlight today, the first of three, is that the customer experience is won or lost on communications. And that may seem like a platitude or really obvious, but I encourage you just to digest that for a second. Customer experience is won or lost on communications. And the customer in this context is any counterparty that you're looking to influence or support through your communications. It could be one of your legacy employees. It could be an employee of the newly acquired company. It could be shareholders of either organization. It could be suppliers or customers. And what we need to recognize here is that even the most loyal flyer or the most highly engaged employee is going to set aside all of their goodwill when your plans completely upend the stability that they've gotten used to. And amid the kind of change that comes with M&A, everyone's on edge. And everyone is suffering along throughout their days without the information that makes them feel comfortable. So every day that we're not communicating, it feels like you're turning the thumbscrews to those stakeholders. Confidence is not built in a vacuum. And while we all know that we're busy behind the scenes, answering the tough questions that come out of an M&A integration, working on solutions, figuring out the best path forward, everyone else is left out in the wild with just the deafening silence of no communications. And so this, in my experience, this is where the airline did very, very well. I was still on site with the clients, and I looked down and I had an email from the airline saying, hey, big storm in your point of connection, very likely going to have some impacts on flight traffic. And they shared everything they knew about the storm, the duration, the intensity, and again, likely impact. They shared what they knew about the impact already. So there were some general stats on flights that had already been delayed. There was a comment that they'd already started to see some diversions and when they expected ground closure to take place. Again, a pretty big storm, but they were out there and aggressive and in front, sharing everything that they could. They even at the end of the message speculated on what the next 24 hours could look like, how they're going to make decisions, how the process would work, and how or what I should expect along the way. So for the majority of the ordeal, the airline gets an A in this regard. I knew that they were working on it, and I knew that while my flights were likely to be canceled, I was provided a general idea of what comes next. There was no absence of communications. So that brings us to our second point. Acknowledge grief, but pursue relief. Response to change is intensely personal. And this might sound indelicate, but no one really, really in this context cares about an apology. I'm sorry that this is turning your world upside down. It may be nice to hear, but it's not going to send an employee home with more comfort that everything's going to be okay or they shouldn't worry about it. And similarly, I'm sorry is not going to get me home on that Friday night or that Saturday morning to my family. People appreciate being heard, and deep down, they already intellectually understand that you might not have the answers, but they're upset, and they're entitled to the opportunity to tell you what they need. Communication plans can anticipate what reactions your different stakeholders are going to have to your deal. Your communication plan may also detail out their likely responses, maybe what their desires are, but those anticipations are not a proxy for actually listening to the folks that are in front of you. And as you listen, you're not only acknowledging their grief in a very real and human way, and maybe it's not grief, maybe it's concerns, maybe it's just questions and they're largely excited about the deal, but you're acknowledging the change in a real way. And it also gives you a chance to talk about what you're doing to remedy the issue. So if someone raises a question regarding how staffing decisions are going to be made, or what is the impact to the product portfolio? What does this mean for the R&D efforts that have been underway for a long time, and selling the company you're buying brings in a suite of products that largely reflect what the R&D efforts we're trying to create?
Poorly executed mergers and acquisitions destroy more value than they create. They can set your company back years. To defend your firm's position in the marketplace, you need access to the leading practices that unlock the greater potential of your people, processes, and systems. If you are undertaking a company transformation or pursuing an acquisition as a vehicle to grow, set up a call with Joe by visiting www.moshercg.com.
As these questions come forward, and as you're listening to them and acknowledging the very real uncertainty that they're experiencing, it's going to give you a chance, outside of an email or a PowerPoint slide or a TikTok video or however you're communicating with your stakeholders, it's going to give you a chance to talk about what you're doing to remedy the issue, what you know, what you don't know. And if the concern is something that you did not anticipate, it's something that you and the team didn't actually consider, it's a chance to own the omission, to thank them for raising it, acknowledge that it's not something you have an answer for, and then commit to what you're going to do next to pursue relief or pursue resolution or pursue some clarity on their behalf. Now, in my experience, again, in the airline situation trying to get home, I'd give my experience here a B minus, but there's two sides to the coin here. Every agent I spoke to over the 48 hours that it ended up taking me to get home, they were all kind, they were all compassionate, they all acknowledged how challenging this was for everyone. And to be clear, I wasn't calling and screaming at anybody. I understood this was weather related, and I just wanted to make sure that I was getting on the quickest and safest path home. But what I observed is that the talent selection and the training for the folks that were on the other end of that call was top notch. And once I got on the phone with someone, I always felt better, even if I did not get answers to everything. I felt heard. I felt that they knew what was going on, and I felt that they were making due efforts to resolve the situation within the best of their abilities. The reason I got a B minus here is because where things really faltered was in the process of actually getting to talk to someone. So wait times, as you can expect, were well over an hour. And that's a pretty tough pill to swallow when you're sitting in an airport. You know, I don't expect anyone to build the church for Easter at the customer service desk, but you need to ensure that you do have some elasticity in your system so that you can handle these high call volumes. It's largely unacceptable for people to be waiting for an hour or more just to talk to somebody to make sure that there's work underway to get them home. And the same goes with M&A integrations. If you assign your HR manager the duties of answering the phones or maybe managing a special M&A concerns email address that you set up internally for stakeholders, what else are you taking off their plate? The work of setting up a dedicated line for everyone to call into when they have a question is not going to mean a whole lot if the person that's supposed to be answering the phone is so busy they can never pick up, or they're so snowed under that they never have a chance to respond to the email. And this brings us to the third and final point I want to share today. Yes, you need to offer options, but you need to lead with solutions. we know that things won't go to plan. Maybe you didn't cause the issue that you're experiencing in your integration, whether it's delays around closure of particular facilities, or maybe it's some things you discovered that's going to require you to run redundant systems and create a lot of complexity and double entry work for employees over an extended period of time. Maybe you didn't cause it. Maybe you didn't anticipate it, but you're still in charge. You need to fix it. When issues arise and there's multiple ways to remedy them, you need to make a decision. One of the things that I've observed is that when there are multiple ways of resolving a particular issue, and I can give you lots of examples, but when there's multiple avenues that are acceptable to management and feasible, there can be a default to providing the two or three paths that an affected person could pursue. That is, I think, good in spirit because you are trying to offer those alternatives and let people make the best decision for them. And so the options are great, but for the weary traveler or the frazzled employee, providing options is really shifting the burden from you to them. So I encourage you to provide the solution. And where appropriate, alternate options for those that have an interest in carrying the burden of solving the issue. So I'll give you a couple of examples that have come up over the last year or so in a couple of different deals that I've worked on. In one case, it was changes to benefits. And what came out of this was the high premium, low deductible medical insurance option was going to change amid the consolidation. And so the question was really, how can you structure your offerings so that those employees that have a very low risk tolerance and would welcome a very high, but a known and fixed monthly premium. So they're paying this high cost up front for an exchange of less volatility or uncertainty on the backside because the majority of their expenses are covered. What do you do to make sure that they get what they need? Simply stripping away that high premium, low deductible option is going to be disruptive to them for a variety of reasons. And so we asked, can you default those affected people to a lower premium, higher deductible, but then perhaps subsidize a portion of that deductible for the first 12 or 24 months post-close as people kind of transition to this new model? Because you have to remember that in the moment of the announcement day, day one integration planning, everything is raw. And something that long-term maybe does not have a real material impact and doesn't carry a long tail of risk is going to feel huge to the people that are experiencing that change. And so this was what we talked about, is could we offer something that was maybe a subsidized portion so that you transitioned everybody to the plans that were available, but then you did something to lay off a bit of the risk in the front end. And then, so while that might have been the default, we know that you're on this plan, that plan's no longer available, we're putting you in here, then you offer a short list of alternatives. So if that really doesn't work for them, here's what is available. So again, it's kind of it's almost like they have to opt out. They have to make the explicit decision that this is not working for me, or I want to know more and I'm going to take it upon myself. Simply sending someone seven different insurance options halfway through their coverage period and telling them to make a decision by the end of the week is going to feel like you've simply taken the burden and shifted it to them. Another example is, how do we handle satellite office closures? So a company I was working with had a lot of small origination offices spread throughout their geographies. And as a result of the closure, they were going to, one, be able to consolidate their people into more service centers. And they're also going to be able to reduce costs by that. But they're also going to ensure culture building by having more people under one roof. So how do we handle those employees that are impacted? So what do we provide them in terms of the default of what's the clarity on who is impacted? How can they post for new roles? What roles can be performed remotely? And what the reload packages might look like for folks that maybe that new location is 200 or 300 miles away. And so the idea of, while they're happy to maybe have the opportunity to post for a job, that means selling their house and buying their house. And even absent high interest rates or low inventory availability in the real estate sector, residential real estate, that's a big commitment. People's faith communities, people's schools, their sports, their friends, their family, et cetera. A lot goes into that. And so while you might provide as a default that overview of the process, here's who's impacted, here's how you can post for roles, here's what you could do remotely from home, here's what reload support looks like. For those that don't have the energy or the desire to post that new position, maybe they can simply opt for a severance agreement and package. And that's something we ended up doing, was to basically say anybody who doesn't land on their feet or anybody who's not interested in pursuing one of these opportunities that's available, you can opt in. for a separation agreement. And so again, you're providing options, but you're leading with the solution. And you want to reduce the burden on your stakeholders as much as you can by making those decisions. And where feasible, and only where feasible, offer alternate paths for those willing to investigate them. I'm not advocating that you offer options for everything. Some things there is a single answer. It is what it is. You need to deliver the medicine and support people through it. But where possible, look to lead with a solution and then secondarily offer options. And this is where things really fell apart for me in the airlines, and they get a well-deserved F. After several different consecutive cancellations, after a diversion to the East Coast and frankly up and down the East Coast, followed by more cancellations, the airline just stopped auto-rebooking me onto the next available flight. And in fact, I was boarding a plane to get me back closer to home, not to home, but closer to home. And I got an alert in the app that my next flight had been canceled. And we were now a full 36 to 38 hours since the end of the storm. And the message was pretty frank. It was something to the effect of, unfortunately, your flight's been canceled and there's no available flights to your destination for at least the next 48 hours. A refund will be issued for this leg of the journey. Thank you for flying XYZ airline. So they had just thrown in the towel. They had no solutions. They had no options. They had no support and no viable way for getting me home. So of course I had to get back into the tortuous phone tree. And spoiler alert, I did eventually get home, but the full burden of issue resolution had been thrust upon me. And I assume hundreds, maybe even thousands of other travelers that were going through the same experience. This is a great example of how not to communicate during intense periods of uncertainty. So what have we covered today? We all know that communications are important, but we're nearly universally doing a lousy job with them. We know there's a lot of tools and templates that are available and they're important, but alone they're not enough. And we have to hold close and hold dear three underlying principles for effective M&A integration communications. Your effort can be won or lost on your communications. It's not just a list of activities to be performed, marked, complete, and set aside. This is to be taken seriously as the critical investments that you're making. You need to acknowledge grief, but pursue relief. Apologizing is free and you can do it often, but without follow-up action, that value goes to zero. Listen to people. Understand what their concerns are, whether you're aware or not, and commit to what you will do to address them. Offer options, but lead with solutions. Never outsource the complexity of the change and the challenges to your stakeholders. Take an informed position and deliver a solution. And if you're in the position to offer options, do it, but only as an opt-in for those that are interested. And then, of course, you know, think twice about flying through the upper Midwest in late February, early March, particularly if you have anything important on the back end of that travel. So that's it for today. And something I want to close with here is over the first dozen episodes of this show, I've been beating the drum of the dangers of value destruction in executing M&A, whether it's the business case, whether it's the governance structure, whether it's communications today, integration readiness, whatever it is. And while I don't believe that any of these warnings or cautions of the risk are overstated, I'm not intending to redirect anyone away from mergers and acquisitions. I just feel like it's really important that buyers are informed of what awaits them, and that awareness and the subsequent preparedness will dramatically improve your outcomes. But to offer a bit more of a balance here, next week we're going to take the other side of the bet. And we're going to give the bull case for agribusiness M&A. And I hope you'll listen, and I hope you'll share some comments and feedback. So thank you for listening to the Pacesetter Pod today. Here's your homework. Please hit subscribe on your podcast player so you don't miss any upcoming episodes. I encourage you to leave a review. This will really help us improve the quality of the show and the relevance of the content. Connect with me, Joe Mosier, and the Mosier Consulting Group on LinkedIn. And if you're in need of assistance or you want to learn more about our proven process, Integration Pacesetter, set up a call by visiting mosiercg.com. And remember, this show is for you. So reach out and let us know what topics are on your mind that you would like to hear about. Finally, and most importantly, thanks again and have a safe day.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.